start off, I understand that not everyone loves art. I personally love art. But why I wanted to do it for my project today was because I think that art can tell you a lot about a person or a group of individuals. And so I wanted to just focus on one specific kind of area in Korean art and kind of analyze what it tells us about what the culture was like and what the people were like at that time, and what the art can tell us about them, what people can tell us about the art. So last time we kind of got a good like basic understanding of how art changed throughout history in Korea, but I'm just going to focus on the Three Kingdoms, the Goryeo, and then the Joseon periods. And so we all know that the Three Kingdom period really was four, but we're going to focus on Goryeo, Baekje, and Chulla, and we'll talk about them first. So since there's three different kingdoms, each one kind of has a different personality, and Goryeo was known as kind of like the warriors. They were horse riders, and they had a very good relationship with China. It was actually under King Hokuto that their battle against China along the Yellow River, and were successful in that. And you can kind of see in their art their personality as a kingdom. They use very bright colors and fluid lines and very dramatic kind of in their art. And obviously their art is going to be kind of what we think of as like caveman art. It's all going to be found in the tombs of important people. And so that's kind of a statistic of how many tombs you can find with murals inside of them, but since this was such a long time ago, really the only art we're going to find is inside of in tombs, and you can see these two pictures that we also saw last time, just more warriors. There's King Hokuto, and you can just kind of see their personality as a people, that they were very successful in the battlefield. They're very proud of that. They're very bold. And it's really interesting because Baekje, the kingdom right next to them, is pretty much like the second sibling, like very quiet. Their art is seen as very delicate and intricate. And in this picture, we see the first depiction of lotus flowers, which is later going to be recognized with the Buddhist religion. But what's interesting about Baekje is they had a good relationship with China, but they also had a very good relationship with Japan. And you can see in that, in this bottom picture here, that is a structure that's in Korea, and there's almost an identical one in Japan, too. And during Baekje, we really see the spread of Buddhism, but we mostly see that through their iron work and their medals and goblet. The last one is a goblet of the king, and it has lotus flowers on it. I don't know if you would normally recognize that as lotus flowers, but you can see how lotus flowers become symbolic of Buddhism, and lots of golden figures of Buddha. And then we're going to go to Chulla, which we know is later conquers both kingdoms. And Chulla is where we really see a lot of expansion because they start using silk and cotton and gold, things like that. And they're actually known as the City of Gold. We know that we can find most of the artwork in Gyeongju, also found in tombs. But what is so interesting about the Chulla period is usually up until this time, Korea kind of looks to China for like an example of how to be cool and what's in kind of. And for the first time we start to see China looking to Korea for what is like fashionable and cool in art. And you can even see pictures of kings in China wearing things that came from Gyeongju. Just shows the influence of art at this time. Like we discussed earlier, here are the mounds in Gyeongju, and mostly what was found here is a lot of gold, and a lot of art that's used as ornamentation for costumes or for everyday wear, and obviously mostly for important people and for kings. And then I just wanted to lightly touch on this because this is a kind of the symbol, I guess, of Gyeongju is the Chanmatseol, and I just think it's interesting, this quote in one of the books that I read clearly like distinguishes, connects this heavenly horse to something that already existed in China before the time. So you can kind of see the connection between China and Korea in their art, and what we take as a symbol of Korea and a symbol of Gyeongju actually pictures. Those are sutra scripts, and you see that they are finely detailed, and also depict followers around Buddha. So art doesn't only become about Buddha himself, but it becomes a way that you can connect spiritually with Buddha, because you can imagine yourself, you know, if you're very devoted and a very good Buddhist person, then you kind of see yourself in the art. And we see more portraits of Buddha, which is also, which we didn't see beforehand. So we see those obviously in sacred places, like in temples. And then we also talked about this last time, so I won't talk about it for very long, but we also see Celadon in the Kodo period, and to us that might not seem very important, but it's something that's very important to Korea. They love to call it their own because it's something important in all of Asia. And the specific color that they were able to obtain and the detail that they could achieve on their pottery was very unique and very easy to attribute this to the Koryo period. And so to Korea, that's a big deal. To us, it might not be, but to Korea, the Celadon is a big thing. And then last, we have Chosun, and this is my favorite one because there's so much expansion in Chosun. And you can see kind of what was going on in history affect art and kind of how art affected history. So first of all, we see a lot more portraits, and not just portraits of Buddha, but of important people, like scholars and queens. And I just think it's interesting because portraits give us such a better idea of who the people were at the time. And then we also get landscapes, and some of these are kind of like the typical art that we think of when we think of Asian art. But it's a huge move from previous art, because it used to be about a specific important person, or maybe Buddha, someone that's that is affiliated with the religion. But now we're getting just an appreciation for Korea as a whole, and more detail, and art kind of becomes more about invoking feelings in people. And then I think what I think is the peak of early Korean art is genre painting. And that is basically just means that it's the lives of regular people. People like washing dishes or clothes or playing outside. And I think that's huge because, like I just mentioned before, even with landscapes, we were getting a move away from important people, because art was only about, you know, very important people in society or in religions. And now we're getting just everyday life, so people can connect with art in a different level. Obviously gets into more homes instead of just in Buddhist temples and palaces. And yeah, there's just a quote that I really liked about that, but I think it's interesting how much the art, when you look at the details, can tell you about what the culture was like and the society was, and it goes hand in hand with what we've learned about in class. So that is all I have. Any questions?